from Abuja.
Hello, we are glad you are part of our show. We appreciate you. I'm Magnus Paco, and this is Magnus Paco GVA. As always, it's all about how we can raise the level of living. That's what it's all about. In view today, the conclusion of our recent discussion with Reverend Professor Yusufu Obaje on the need for a national ideology in Nigeria. It's a national ideology what is needed for unity and a faster pace of growth in the country. But before that, in our hidden economics, what the money is saying. Now, up next in our quick view, we rank the top musicians in earnings. That's coming right up. Musicians are making a lot of money these days, relying not just on CD, vinyl, or digital sales, but mostly counting on concert tours and performances and a little of other things like music streaming, digital, and merchandise sales like perfumes, t-shirts, and other memorabilia, and mostly online. In this connection, which of the following very popular musicians was not in the top 5 in the world in overall earnings in 2015? Taylor Swift, Kenny Chesney, The Rolling Stones, and Adele. Not including Akon, who in reality is an American, who was the top earning musician in Africa in 2015? Don Jazzy, D'Banj, P-Square, and Wizkid. Stay with us for our answers coming up shortly. Still in view, does Nigeria need a national ideology? But up next in our hidden economics, what the money is saying. Money. Why do people talk about it so much? If you display a lot of it, what does it say about you? When Davido sings about the money, along with Olamide, he just wants the money because it makes people think you have a lot of honey and you might just share it with them. Now, Davido in this video is actually teaching a small course in economics by indirectly suggesting the value function of money and using that to illustrate the importance of money. To economists, there are three main functions of money. One, money is primarily a medium of exchange so that it can be used to facilitate transactions. Two, money can serve as a unit of account so as to have a common measure of the value of goods and services exchanged. Then three, money can be a store of value. In order to be a medium of exchange, money must hold its value over time. However, money is more liquid than most other stores of value, and so it is readily accepted everywhere. So people like Davido and Olamide know that their cherished clients will want it. Why do people want money? Well, for what it will buy today or tomorrow. People value any given amount today than they would tomorrow because inflation tends to diminish the value of money, except when the money is invested and the real interest rate is positive. So people want to associate with someone who has a lot of money today. But in all this, that money must have a lot of value. the money must be able to hold its value. If that money is believed to be able to hold its value, and if you can show your client that you have plenty of it, then since it is a store of value, it probably means you have a lot more wealth and value where this money came from, which means you must be important. And so to your clients, this cash may only represent the tip of the iceberg for you. Therefore, they will feel very lucky to have met you. Our hidden economics for you. Before we start our discussion, here are our quick view answers. Adele's album Mega Sales and Meteoric Rise notwithstanding, concert tours is the determining factor for the 40 genre-spanning acts that topped Billboard's ranking of music's highest-paid musicians of the past year. And just like that, Adele is not among the top 5 musicians in earnings in 2015. Just in case you want to know, Adele came in a distant 9th place, but not to worry, she raked in a nice looking $20.5 million in 2015. Nothing to sneeze at there. In Africa, Nigerian musicians dominate the ranking, with Don Jazzy as the top earner in 2015. For comments, adverts, and sponsorship, please see our information displayed on the screen. As we said last time, many countries have attempted to link national ideology to state structure, survival, and economic progress. In Nigeria, attempts have been made through national conferences and individual statements to determine a way forward for national progress. Today we conclude our earlier discussion on the subject with Reverend Professor Yusufu Ame Obaje. Professor Obaje is a theology scholar and social commentator and was a pioneer State House chaplain of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. He is also a former president of the Nigerian Baptist Convention. In 2007, he was a candidate for the governor of Kogi State. Professor Obaje has written many books and believes Nigeria needs a national ideology. Please join us as we conclude our discussion with Reverend Professor Obaje.
We are all sad that our educational system over the years, not just this period, has been going down because there is no nation that can actually develop without these two cardinal renaissances or rebirth. Spiritual renaissance and intellectual renaissance.
But what am I afraid, well, what I'm afraid of is we have a very poor and to some extent illiterate society.
Yes.
So how would this renaissance happen, especially the intellectual one? Wouldn't it be through some sort of a classroom environment?
You know,
and then the spiritual one, is it through the mosque and the churches?
Yes.
Or where will it be? Where would this happen?
Very simply, when I was going to Kogi some years ago, trying to say, look, I'm going to be strive to be a governor of the state, I drew up my program. These two were cardinal. And I was saying, look, there are so many jobless youths who have gone through the universities, who have gone through some tertiary institutions that we can engage. We could go to the villages, seat our fathers under whatever tree, and begin to let them even read and write.
Okay.
Divide them.
Yeah.
There are layers of this responsibility.
Absolutely.
In 2010, I wrote a paper on our decision when we're talking about should Jonathan continue, or should we go for a fresh election, or should he contest, or he should just look. I said, look, where we are now, let's forget about 2011 election. Let's give this mandate, through a doctrine of necessity part 2. Yes. I say, in that doctrine of necessity part two, we should empower this man to say you have 2 or 3 years.
What if there was a doctrine of necessity part three that somebody else brought up?
Oh, yes, after that we could, part three. Yeah. But that part two would have given this man the power to say, okay, look, do the following things for us. The number one in what I was suggesting there, it is massive education. Massive, because, you know, democracy is a system that cannot be run under the flat tire of ignorance and illiteracy. It's not possible. It's not a system that illiterates can handle. You know, it's a very involved intellectual system. And when you have a sea of human beings who cannot even read and write, who cannot even understand what the term means and the implications, who cannot even appreciate what it means to vote and who to vote for. You know, what you have, you lean on commercial mandate.
What is that?
That people are going to buy the offices.
Okay.
They're not going to be voted for. And that has been our experience.
So but, is that what is happening now?
Exactly.
You're trying to say that that's what's happening
now? Yes, this is what is happening.
Okay.
You know, I sometimes tease people, they say, oh, this man is failing. I say, you went there, you collected money, you didn't vote according to your conscience. All over. I was out there myself.
So that's called a commercial mandate.
Commercial mandate, yes. It's out of a book I wrote, 10 types of political mandate. Commercial mandate is one of them. And that is a crazy thing because I saw it myself.
Yes.
I've been there with them contesting for election from PDP to DPP, DPP to
I was following
ACN,
you
from ACN happening? To ABGA. I've got to accord. Yes. I have seen in all the journeys from 2007 to recently.
Quite an experience.
Yes. And I did that because I wanted to know Nigerian politics.
Yeah.
And I saw it.
What if he had become governor?
Oh, my platform
would have been. Would you have succeeded?
Oh, by the grace of God. Number one, my success.
Wouldn't you have been a lone ranger? You have all this philosophy, all this understanding, and then you got this sea of people around you that are gone the other direction, commercially or whatever.
I would have succeeded because my success would have been rooted on what I sincerely believe: with God, all things are possible.
Okay.
God would have given me the enablement.
Absolutely.
And after every election that I took part at home, I would wait for either a month or 2 months or 3 months sometimes and gather youths and try to educate them. Say, look, this is what politics is all about. And this is what your vote is, your life, is your water, is your road, is your education, is your this. And I was getting a lot of disciples among these youths in the villages. They will go and invite their friends to come.
I believe you're still doing that because I've seen that you've got that conference.
Yes.
I encourage you to
I'm happy that I'm doing that with my Okada and Tricycle. I'm their Grand National Patron. And I hold meetings with them and I'm so pleased that a lot of them, they used to buy this idea.
It's good, yeah.
And I say this very strongly that, believe me, that 2010, I say, look, forget about this corpus being posted here and there. Let's train these corpus. Train them for 3 months and then send them out like Jehovah Witness from door to door, from house to house, all over the Federation, telling people, this is the meaning of democracy. This is the power that you have as an individual. Your vote is your life, is your education, is your water, is your electricity, is your good road, is your health. Don't sell it. If you sell it, you have sold your life. And we do this for 2 or 3 years.
That's very good.
2 or 3 years. Yeah. You know, said, look, that was just one item. Massive political education for the Nigerian people.
And when they succeed, they might become politicians.
Exactly.
And not politicians.
Absolutely.
I was fascinated.
You know, why I coined that term was the fact that I've gone through all kinds of dictionaries and encyclopedias trying to look for the meaning of politics.
Yes.
And I have never come across any negative definition of politics.
Yes.
All is positive. Science of administration, art of governance, and the host of it. There's nothing. And yet, on the field, from 2007, in action, not an observer outside, somebody who took part in all these attempted elections, see, 2007, I thought, hey, somewhere there, people started seeing politics as something that is totally negative. They would even say, what are you doing there as a pastor? That place is evil. Politics is dirty. I used to tell the people, politics is not dirty, but there are dirty people in politics. These dirty people are the ones we call polysatians. Satan-centered, demon-centered. Because they do not have the interest of the people in mind. Whereas a politician is an instrument in the hands of the Almighty God. He's God's representative. He's an agent of God in trying to administer the universe, the world, the nation, the country, the local area, with God as the supreme leader. Today, they don't want to think about this God who is to direct us.
Okay, Professor, as we try to wind down here,
yes.
There are two areas that I would like you to pay some attention to. One is the role of God in the national ideology thing. You know, are all national ideologies pinned on God? You know, so that's that's the one. Then you mentioned in your book and even in your discussion here, this idea of selfless service. What is selfless service? So if you pick up selfless service, and then probably wind up with the reverend, wind up with the rule of God in the national ideology debate.
Well, the first place is that, you know, God is the supreme creator, sustainer, redeemer, the all in all of our lives. No matter which name we give to him. Is the one who creates all, and yet he himself is not created. So everything belongs to him. Government, the individual, institutions, they are all his. Human beings are invited to say, look, I have created you in my image so that you can join hands with me as we go on in recreating and recreating the universe, the world in which we live in. So God has a priority over every decision that we make. And this is very true in our traditional religions. You know, in spite of the excessive preoccupation with the divinities and intermediary agents of God, which did not make it pure monotheism, they were conscious of the fact that you can't go to farm without consulting the intermediaries representing the Supreme Presence. You can't go to the stream without consulting. Every life was lived in conscious dependence of the Supreme Being, who is the owner of all. I believe very strongly that it is against that background that I see service that I render is not just mine. I am only an instrument in the hands of the Almighty God. Therefore, first thing that I consider in service is the other person. What will I do to make the other person fulfill the purpose for which God created that person? And in doing
But that is you as a reverend. The regular person, are people really selfless?
No, we are not born in terms of to be self-centered. You know, the innate gift that God gave to each human is that we are our brother's keeper.
Okay.
Yes.
That's good.
God has already done that.
We've been told that.
Yes. We are brought up in the culture of living for others.
That's good.
And therefore living for God.
Absolutely.
Now what has happened is for us to defeat the materialism of our age, the godlessness of our age, that is drying up this value that God has given to us in creation. So that's why they kept on saying, look, if we have spiritual renaissance and intellectual renaissance, we can all wake up and Nigeria can easily become the greatest nation on earth with all the human and natural resources that the Almighty God has offered us.
Professor, on that note, I want to thank you so very much. You are extraordinary.
I'm glad to be here, and I thank God for the opportunity. Thank you very much. And this is something that I will always cherish. This is a beautiful center.
Thank you so much.
And Almighty God bless you and encourage you to continue to a greater height.
Amen.
In this that you are doing. It's a mission.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
An ideology is a set of ideas and beliefs of a group or political party. So do we need that in Nigeria? Who will provide these ideas and beliefs? The president? The National Assembly? The judiciary? And what will the ideology be to resonate across a diverse country like Nigeria? The fundamental liberal ideals of freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion for all belief systems, the separation of church and state, the right to due process, and equality under the law are widely accepted ideals of the American liberalism ideology. Now, modern liberalism in the United States embraces issues such as same-sex marriage, voting rights, civil rights, and access to social security, including healthcare and even welfare. The major political parties in the United States don't always agree on every element thrown up in liberalism. For example, many elements of the Republican Party vigorously oppose same-sex marriage and even mandated healthcare programs. Recently, Vladimir Putin, president of Russia, has said that he was not trying to impose a single state ideology and said many alternative theories would be tolerated. His belief is that unifying approaches on the teaching of history does not imply state-imposed bureaucratic and ideological unification. Considering all this, I think it is possible that Nigerians can agree to a Nigerian can-do spirit that believes that every Nigerian is equal under the law and free under the law to be the best in the country and in the world without repression concerning religion or ethnicity. As we agreed last time, an ideology is after all merely a comprehensive normative vision that is followed by a people, a community, a society, or even a nation. So a national ideology can define or reflect the structure of the nation and its stability by adopting ideals that are considered to be the usual and correct ways of doing something. I think we can hang our hat on this. In the final analysis, the Nigerian political parties would draw their own ideologies from a central premise that all Nigerians consider to be a usual and correct way of doing something. Even so, these so-called party ideologies will have their own specific and identifying elements. The debates as to which elements are more useful to a Nigerian global ascendancy would be what establishes winning solutions, depending on geography and economic or social orientation. And so, as we concluded, we need, in general, a Nigerian can-do spirit that is courageous, honest, fair, and committed to the pursuit of personal excellence that brings glory to God. I'm Magnus Paco, and that's my view.
Thank you.